What's up, YouTube? It's time to talk about this love, death, and robots. Look into my eye.
Yeah. 2 Chainz. What's that on that beat, ho? I'm different, yeah, I'm different. I'm different, yeah, I'm different. I'm different, yeah, I'm different. Pull up to the scene with my ceiling missing. Pull up to the scene with my ceiling missing. Pull up to the scene with my ceiling missing. Pull up to the scene with my ceiling missing. Middle finger up to my competition. I'm different, yeah, I'm different.
What's up, YouTube? It's Artisan MC, and I'm here to talk to you about Love, Death, and Robots on Netflix. I first heard about this show about a week ago. One of my buddies came in, and while we were sitting there talking shit about Captain Marvel, he mentioned the show. So I'm a cinephile, meaning somebody who loves to watch movies and stuff like that. So I watch almost anything, especially if it's in my wheelhouse and I'm interested in it. So popped on Netflix and watched a bit of it, and I have to say I really liked it. Since way back, since I was a kid, since I was hand-drawing my own little flip books and stuff like that in school, I'm a fan of anime, animation, and art. And for the most part, this series covers all of that. And it pushes the line a little further with animation because it uses CG animation in some spots, which looks, in some scenes, photorealistic, which is pretty good. So from what I understand, the show starts off being run by David Fincher and someone else that actually came together to make this whole Netflix series. And understand that it's supposed to be an adult series. Okay. It's supposed to be for adults. There's nudity, there's sexual situations, you know, penises, breasts, all kind of stuff flying around in here. But if you look past all of that, it is a really graphically beautiful piece of animation to me. For me, watching this 18 episodes, and trust and believe, I just binged it. I just watched it straight through until it was finished and enjoyed every one of the things that I saw, some more than others. For me, it harkens back to when I first started watching anime on TV and seeing movies like Robot Carnival and shows like Liquid Television on MTV. And just in general, I always love that anthology series, that something short is happening, you get to see it, and then you move on to the next thing. So you can see another different take, maybe on the same subject matter, maybe from a different perspective, but just somebody else's vision crammed into the same thing. I always enjoy that. So this one follows suit. You know, watching it, I was recalling the Animatrix, which was heavy. Batman Gotham Knight, which was in there as well. I was seeing a lot of really good animation styles. Heavy Metal was another one that just takes it back even further. But this one deals with the subject of mostly robots, aliens, and just weird technology. Excuse me, the segments that I like the most are ones, some that are photorealistic and some that really just capture the essence of being able to tell a story succinctly in a short amount of time. I mean, it's like visual haiku, if you would. Being able to get that image and understand those characters in a short amount of time is awesome because, as we know, we've watched movies that are 2 hours or more, and you still don't know who the character is after it's over. So to be able to do that in a short span, like 5-10 minutes, is awesome to me. So to get into this, I'm a huge fan of animation. This has been a passion of mine for a long time, which led into comics, which led into cartoons, which led into anime when I got older, which leads right here to this Love, Death, and Robots. Although there are 18 episodes, some episodes stuck out more than others to me, and those are the ones that I'll focus on in this review instead of trying to give you a rundown on all of them. Because at the end of the day, me personally, I want you to see it. I want you to have your own opinion about what's going on and hear my opinion as just an aside to what you figure out for yourself, you know. So first off is the first episode, which is Sunny's Edge. And this is a hell of a way to open this show because it lets you know right off the bat what you're going to be dealing with from start to finish. It is CG motion capture animation, but it's photorealistic and it looks really damn good. Watching this one, I would live in this world. And the world is basically where human beings use some kind of neural implant to jack in and control creatures, which look like kaijus from Pacific Rim. And they control these creatures in fights. And the story focuses on Sunny and this last fight that she's in. You know, this is her 17th fight and she's 16-0. She's just been winning. And the guy offers her some money to take a dive and she doesn't take it. And the question is, why won't she take it? You know, how is she so good? And I don't want to spoil the episode because I don't like spoiling things like that, but I will tell you, it was in some parts sexual. There was blood. I mean, it's basically a kaiju fight. What else are you going to see? But it had a good story. I really enjoy that. The second one I enjoyed was Beyond the Oculus Rift. And this one is another motion capture CG type of animation, but it's sci-fi in a sense because it happens out in space. Okay, these, I don't know what they were. This crew was on their ship and they're about to get slingshotted a couple hundred light years away from Earth. And they end up in the wrong place way off course. And what happens to them after that is the stuff of kind of nightmares, in a sense. Again, photorealistic, and this episode was very sexual. Next one after that was boy and this fox spirit end up having a relationship that spans, you know, decades. All the way up into the point where their country is taken over by Europeans and they industrialize the place and are really fucking, you know, shitty to women, really abusive and stuff like that. And this fox spirit gets caught up in all of that. And this has more of a steampunk vibe. The animation style is cell animation, but the color looks beautiful. I mean, Good Hunting is the story of highlights and the colors on it really pop and really look good. It was very beautiful to look at, especially the animation with the fox and the tails and stuff like that. I really liked that. I skipped one and it was The Witness. I really enjoyed The Witness. That was a really good twist. This is perhaps the most sexual episode in the whole series. And this woman is basically in her house getting ready for work and she witnesses murder. And the person that she sees through the window sees her and gives chase. I like how it ended. I am a fan of stories that loop. To do that in a short format is, I don't know, skillful to me. It's very skillful. So I enjoyed this story. There does come a scene where it's really sexual and you all up in between some chick's leg. I mean, if that's a spoiler, whatever. But this is by far the most sexual fucking episode. And to the point that I thought I was seeing a bit much, even for anime. Because you have to understand that in this one, it is motion capture CD, CGI, right? So someone is doing this. That means somebody was filming it. Even if the woman was in a green suit or whatever, she had to do all of this stuff. And it just seems like kind of pervy at a part. So Next episode comes into Shapeshifters. This was a story of a military unit, and it has what you find out are fucking werewolves in the unit. And they are in some sand country where these werewolves are basically the point men for military operations. And this is like real world, real time. And you get the story of these two werewolves and who they are within this unit and what happens when one of these werewolves gets killed and what that soldier does afterwards. I like the photorealistic look. I'm a fan of, you know, cell animation and hand-drawn art, but this one, these episodes like this really stood out to me because it's just visually just amazing. The next episode for me is Fish Night. This one is by far the one that just gave me that Miyazaki feel for the most part. So if you know who Miyazaki is, he made Kiki's Delivery Service, Spirited Away, Princess Mononoke, and he always deals with spirits because he's coming from the Japanese culture point of view. This episode in Love, Death, and Robots for Fish Night gave me that feel. This episode, you have two men, a young one and an older one, and they're co-workers, and maybe they're salesmen or something like that, and they're driving and their car stalls in the middle of the desert somewhere. Well, what ends up happening is night falls, and when night falls, stranger things happen in the desert, and what they get is all these floating, ghostly fish. All kind of sea life just floating around, huge as fuck, in like neon. And it's a beautiful freaking scene, which reminds me of Miyazaki. If you've ever seen any of his movies, there's always some parade or something like that of spirits or something like that around. Little things that you would never see normally, but as soon as it hits nighttime, these little things are out and they're walking around and just living their life. So that one, that episode goes along and it's really interesting. It has a fucked up end for one of them, but it was really, really good. It still looked beautiful, but I don't care. The next one goes to my favorite episode, which is Zima Blue. And Zima Blue is very stylized 2D animation. The color palette is, I wouldn't say pastel, but it's really off. It's really a distinct style. It's about as distinct as watching Batman the Animated Series all over again and never having seen it before, to see how cleanly the lines are drawn, how cleanly this figure has an image that attracts your eye and you really look at it and are curious of how they're putting these things together and how they're drawing them. And for me, Sigma Blue is about an artist looking for answers about the universe. He just keeps making bigger and bigger spectacles, stage in a sense, of this art. And it's all about this color and this big blue period that he was going through. But when you get through all of that, you get down to an episode that's really philosophically deep. I mean, and that stood out to me in my mind because I liked that twist. That twist and leaving me with that little nugget of contemplating my own life or whatever is why I watch different movies and stuff like that, because I want to see if somebody else is on the same wavelength mentally as I am. And this one just really stood out visually. It's very distinct. So with that, that's the end of my review on Love, Death, and Robots. I would highly suggest, if you're a fan of anime, if you're a fan of gory action or video games or whatever, you can watch this. You can watch this and enjoy it. And we can actually talk about it a little bit. Leave some stuff in the comment section and we can go back and forth about it. Because although I wanted to review it, I don't want to spoil it. I am not a spoiler in no sense of the word. I will look out for your own intellectual purity and not spoil things for you, but give you enough to whet your appetite to either watch it or don't watch it. It's up to you. So, like, share, and subscribe. As always, thanks to the Angry Man and Angry Man Army. Peace to Cerulean Gray and the Gray Regime. And much thanks to Master Teacher BGS Ibmore and the Ibmore Dynasty. And I will see you guys next time. Peace.
My spidey senses is tingling. Feel something. Got my radars.